This is a joint work with Zbigniew Borokierski from the Weizmann Institute. So there is a very long title, so I'll break it down. So we begin with the fully homomorphic encryption. So assume that I have a cell phone and I have some data stored in it, and let's call the data X, and I want to compute a function of my data. And the function is very complicated, and my cell phone doesn't have much computational power, so instead of computing it on my cell phone, I prefer to do the computation on the server. So in the very naive approach, what do? So I send my data to the server, and I let the server do the hard job, and it computes F, and it simply send back the result. So this is all very nice and naive, but what if the server is malicious and I want to keep my data private? So I generate a public key and a secret key, and I want it to be of a special encryption scheme such that when I send the server an encryption of my data, it can run some evaluation algorithm, and when I decrypt the evaluated ciphertext, I get f of x. So even though I've sent him encrypted data, I can still recover f of x without doing too many work. And we call this property full homomorphism if it holds for every circuit f. And also we want semantic security. So I want that an encryption of 0 would look like an encryption of 1. And throughout this talk, I will assume that we encrypt bit by bit. So this is the fully homomorphic setting. And what if we have two parties, each having its own public key and secret key, and each having its own data x and y? And I want to compute a function both of f, a function f of x and y. So what do we do in the multi-key settings? So each party computes an encryption, and now the server runs the evaluation algorithm on both ciphertexts. And we want to have the property that when two parties meet together and run a decryption algorithm on the evaluated ciphertext, we get f of x and y. So this is the multi-key settings. And sometimes we want to relax the settings, and we assume that the two parties share public parameters. And what do I mean by that? I mean that when generating the public key and secret keys, they're not completely independent, they also depend on the public parameters. We also want to get a stronger notion of a multi-key FHE, which we call multi-hop. Well, multi-hop could have many interpretations, so what do I mean by multi-hop? That assume that the two parties made some computation with the server and got to do C hat 1, C hat 2, and etc. And all of a sudden, there comes a new party, says, hold on a minute, I want to join the computation, and it's after the fact. The other parties already made some computations. And we want the new party to be able to send its own encryption, and the server could still run an evaluation algorithm such that when it's decrypted, it would decrypt to the right value, and know that C hat are already evaluated ciphertext. So this is multi-hop in the sense that we evaluate the ciphertext with a new party. And ideally, we want a fully dynamic encryption, and I mean by that polynomially unbounded number of parties could join the computation. So if you had all these parties doing the computation, you can have always someone new to join. So let's cover some previous works that has been done. So the first work is by Lopez, Strummer, and Vaikonathan, which first introduced multi-key FHE, and they also gave the first scheme. So the scheme was multi-hop, but the number of parties that could use such a scheme has to be previously known. Also, the scheme had no public parameters, which is very good. And the space complexity of evaluation, we could just think about it now as the length of the ciphertext, grew like this, where epsilon could be very small. It depends on the security parameter, and it is at least quadratic. And the cryptographic assumption is n-proof, which we just talked about. There was another work by Clear and McGoldrick, and then which was simplified and rephrased by Mukherjee and Weeks. And their scheme wasn't multi-hop, but it was the first work that supported an unbounded number of players. Also, the scheme had public parameters, and the space complexity, the length of the ciphertext was still quadratic in the number of players, but the cryptographic assumption was length errors. So our work continues their line of work, and we get multi-hop, and we also keep the unbounded number of players. So this is the first fully dynamic encryption scheme. But we also have public parameters, And the space complexity is efficient. It's linear in the number of players. And the assumption is also LWD. There are two concurrent works. The first one also continued the line of work from Kovigi and Wicks. And it was multi-hop, but the number of players is bounded. The scheme also had public parameters, and the length of the ciphertext was quadratic, and the assumption is length errors. The other concurrent work is a bit different. It is multi-hop. It can support an unbounded number of players, so it is fully dynamic, and it has no public parameters. And here, the space complexity of evaluation is quadratic, and it has short ciphertext. But the cryptographic assumption is a PIO, which is not a standard assumption. Saying that, the cryptographic assumption for all previous works beside this one needs to assume circular security, which I'll talk about later, which is not a standard assumption, but we also need that for just FHE, not a fully dynamic encryption. So our starting point is the fully homomorphic encryption by Gentry, Saha, and Waters. And in these settings, we have a matrix, which is short and wide, which would play the role of the ciphertext. And the secret key would be a vector, and it would have this special form that the last element is normalized. And we want to have the following property, that when I multiply the secret key by the ciphertext, I get something that looks approximately like the message times the secret key times a special matrix G called the gadget matrix. And for those of you who don't know what a gadget matrix is, just keep in mind that it is a diagonal matrix having all the powers of 2 up to in mod Q. But just keep in mind that it is diagonal matrix. And what do I mean by this approximately? Well, I mean that the difference between what we actually have, which is the secret key times the ciphertext, and what we would like to have, which is the message times the secret key times the gadget matrix, the difference is very small. And why is this property good for us? Well, first of all, let us do decryption. So we said we only encrypt bits. So if we encrypt the bit 0, so the multiplication would look like 0, which has only very small elements. But if we encrypted 1, well, it will have this form. What's special about this form, recall that G is this matrix, and the last element of the secret key is normalized. So whereas when we encrypt 0, the last element would be very small, when we encrypt 1, the last element would be very large because we multiply 1 by the highest power of 2. So as long as this difference is smaller than the Q over 8, we can decrypt. And actually for decryption, because we only looked at the last elements, we don't need the whole matrix to do decryption. We can only take the last column of the ciphertext. But we do need the whole matrix for some reason, because it allows to do homomorphic operations. I won't talk about why does this work, but just to mention it. So we do this arithmetic operation where G is not a square matrix, so the inverse is not well defined. But it turns out that it's actually a pretty efficient algorithm. It is just to decompose the elements into bits. So if I do that, I get the NAND of the encryptions. And this works only to a certain point of operation, because after I do this many times, the noise is too big and we can't decrypt. So how do you get around that? Because we want full homomorphism, we want to be able to decrypt any homomorphic operation of any circuit. So assuming I have this circuit C, and up to this point I can do these NAND operations. So what do I do in the last point that I can do? So I'll evaluate a slightly larger circuit, and this part would be this circuit, which has the two ciphertext CB1 and CB2 hard-coded into it. So what do? I take the input X and use it to decrypt the first ciphertext and the second one and take their NAND. And what is good about this circuit? Because if I plug in the secret key, I get exactly the NAND of B1 and B2, which is one I want to get. So if I evaluate it homomorphically, I go for an encryption of the bit B1 and the bit B2 to encryption of their NANDs. So we can keep doing NAND, and it also because we ran decryption, so the noise is being canceled. So we can keep doing this operation and get fully homomorphism. But this requires an additional assumption because I assume we have an encryption of the secret key. which is generally not secure, so we need an additional assumption called circular security. It's not a standard assumption, but as I said earlier, this is the only way we can get FHE besides IO. So how do we go from this into the multi-key settings? So the main idea is we have an encryption of some bit under a single player, and we want to extend it into a larger matrix for more players. So there is such, there is an extend algorithm, and this matrix C hat has a special form, which is like, which has only elements on the diagonal and some row, and it has the property, like I said, it has only a linear number of non-zero blocks. And when I concatenate all the secret keys and I do this multiplication, I get the property that we talked about earlier. So we can still do decryption and evaluation as before. So this extend algorithm lets us go to multi-key settings. Point is, we can do this extend algorithm only once, so it is only single hop. If you could have extended many times, it would be multi-hop, but it doesn't work. So our goal is to make this scheme multi-hop, and we also want to get shorter ciphertext. In the scheme before, the ciphertext were matrices, so it was n squared. And we also want to get a more efficient space for the evaluation. So we'll begin with getting multi-hop. So we have two ciphertexts, C1 encrypted under a red party and C2 encrypted under a blue party. And we want to run some evaluation algorithm that when I decrypt this evaluated ciphertext, I get the NAND, I get the NAND of the two bits. And if I could do that, I can do multi-key FHE, because without the loss of generality, the circuit is only of NAND gates, and I can go from any party, the red one and the blue one, to the joint party. So how do I do that? So we start with the single key settings. So we said that instead of running the NAND, we run this larger circuit, and when I plug in the encryption of the secret key, I get C hat, and when I decrypt C hat, I get the NAND of B1 and B2. But now we are in the multi-key settings, and to decrypt C1, we need the red party, and to decrypt C2, we need the blue party. So what do we do? So instead of plugging in encryption of the single public key, we plug in all the encryption of all the secret keys. And this would still work because we have a multi-key evaluation. So the decryption would still be what we want. It would be the NAND of B1 and B2. And the important thing to note is that we don't re-evaluate the public encryption of the secret key. If you want to evaluate the circuit again, we just use these again, which aren't the output of evaluation algorithm. So we actually need only single hop to do this. And since we have single hop for the previous work, running this circuit gives us multi-hop. So the next step is we want to decrease the length of the ciphertext. So we said that if all we wanted to do is decryption, we can only take the last column of the matrix. So what we are going to do is to simply generate the last column of the matrix, which will give us linear length ciphertext. So the public parameters, public key and secret key, are as in the single hop scheme. But now we're going to generate only column ciphertext. But how can we do evaluation now? Because we needed a matrix for a reason. So it seems that we kind of lost the point of giving up on the old matrix. So let's go over again what we said we do in the decryption. So we have the encryption of the secret keys, and we decrypt the hard-coded encryptions. We decrypt the hard-coded ciphertext and get C hat. So we said that the public key is as before, and the public key contains the encryption of the secret key. But this time we have only vector ciphertext. Thing is, it still works, because for decryption we only need the last column of the matrix. So decryption still works, but we get a matrix ciphertext. So how do we get around that? We simply cut it off, and to get back the vector ciphertext, which is linear length, the number of parties. But the downside of all this whole procedure is that we get the space complexity to be squared, and we want the space complexity to be linear. So how do we get around that? So first, make a few observations. We can do some homomorphic operation even though we have only vector ciphertext. So we can do addition by simply adding the two ciphertexts. I won't get into why this works, but take it as a fact. And we can also do multiplication. Well, it is not clear how to multiply two vectors, so we can do tensor product, but it wouldn't work very well. So I assume that we have that at least one of the ciphertexts has to be a matrix for multiplication to work. And if this matrix is very sparse, for example, if it has a linear number of non-zero elements, which we know the structure of the matrix, then we can do multiplication in linear space, and addition is also in linear space. And remember that after the extend algorithm, the matrix had a very specific form, which had, which was very sparse, and then only linear number of non-zero blocks. So if this C1 matrix has been a matrix that has only been extended, we can run the multiplication algorithm in linear space. But if we ran some evaluation on this matrix, it would lose its form, it would lose its sparseness, and we couldn't do a space-efficient multiplication. So keep that in mind, and we use these two observations to reduce the space of the evaluation. So for that, I'll need the model of branching programs. So what are branching programs? It is a rather intuitive model of computation. So we have L layers, in this case L would be 4, and we have some width, which in this case is also 4, and we start and we evaluate the branching program layer by layer. So we start in this layer, and we look at our input, which is be indicated by variable 1, and we see if the bit is 0 or 1. If the bit 0, we take the red arrow, otherwise we take the blue arrow, and this way we advance to the next layer. And this way we go from one layer to another until we get to the last one. And if we ended up in this point, we accept, and otherwise we reject. So these are branch programs. And the main idea is we utilize branching programs. So instead of evaluating this circuit, we're going to transform it into a branching program. And this is due to Barrington. And it says that this transformation could be done efficiently. And we actually can do it on the fly. And what do I mean by on the fly? That we can output each layer of the branching program efficiently. So the idea is, instead of evaluating this circuit, which requires a quadratic space, we'll transform it to a branching program, and we will evaluate the branching program homomorphically instead of evaluating homomorphically this circuit. So how do we do that? If we take a look, closer look at branching programs, we see this as each step in the layers, we actually go from either the blue arrow or the red one. And by looking at the input, we can see which one we take. So it is actually, it actually has a very simple formula. So y prime would be a y1 if x is 1, and it would be y0 if x is 0. And we can evaluate this formula efficiently. So x is the is the input that we have, and we assume that x would be a vector encryption. X is the input for the branching program, which is an encryption of the secret key. And in the encryption of the secret key, it would be very sparse, because it has only been extended. And y0 and y1 are only the vector encryptions. So we can do this multiplication and addition using just linear space. And by the correctness of the branching program, we would eventually, after evaluating all these each step of the layer, we get linear space. So there are a few ideas for future work. First of all, we would like to do it without public parameters, which would be very good, but it's not clear how to do that. And it would be also interesting to get even shorter ciphertext. We're not sure it is possible to get the ciphertext to be linear. The number of players could be a lower bound, but we are not sure about it. And a main direction would be to get a fully dynamic encryption without the need for a circular security. And actually, it is not known even for a fully homomorphic encryption. It would be interesting to get simply that. So this is it, and thank you very much for listening.